Okay, good morning, ladies and gentlemen, dear participants. I'm very happy to welcome you at the FAO webinar on harvest and post-harvest practices to reduce food loss and waste. We organized this webinar as a series under FAO's Regional Safe Food Initiative, which is a regional food loss and waste program for Europe and Central Asia. And this is part of our capacity building efforts. This very webinar is the first in the series, which is aiming at identifying and promoting good practices and inspire transformative interventions to prevent and to reduce food loss and waste along all the supply chains. And each webinar will focus on a specific stage of the food supply chain from production to consumption, offering practical solutions to the issues that are at stake. And these solutions then should be able to be replicated or scaled up at national or regional level. So our speakers today will highlight key concepts and problems of the harvest and post-harvest segments of the food supply chain, and present solutions and cases for effective intervention to reduce food losses. Before I give the floor to the first speaker, I would like to make a few practical notes for the arrangements of this meeting. The presentations will be made in English, and we have simultaneous translation into Russian and into Turkish, and you will find the language switch and on the small globe icon at the bottom of your screen. We would be very happy to receive your questions at any time during the presentations, and these questions and comments we ask you to write in the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. Please do not use the chat box for this, but the Q&A box as well. And you can also submit these questions, write these questions into Russian or into Turkish, if you wish. When you write a question, please indicate your name and indicate the name of the speaker or panelist that you want to address the question to. This webinar is being recorded and broadcasted on YouTube as well. Okay, having said that, now I would like to give the floor to our first speaker, which is Ms. Josiane Cloutier. She's a post-harvest consultant and researcher at Wageningen University and Research. In her presentation, she will focus on the ways that science and innovation help introduce food loss across the food supply chains. Josiane, it's your turn. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Robert. Thank you for being here today. Today, I will have a talk about how science and innovation help reduce food losses across the agri food chain. So imagine the effect of zero food loss and waste on your business, and what will it be the impact on the efficiency of your business? And can we reduce waste? Well, this is why we're here today. But before addressing this question, we first need to know what are the reasons of post-harvest losses. Well, we have to keep in mind that fresh fruits and vegetables are alive. So they breathe, and that rhythm of breathing is affected by temperature. So the lower the temperature, the lower they will do the respiration. But it can also be affected by the level of oxygen, CO2, and ethylene. And of course, this process of breathing will generate heat. Let's not forget that. And that is important to know and to keep in mind in the post-harvest management. There are several sources of post-harvest losses. If we look at the use of oxygen, that produces heat, as in the first picture on the top left, the temperature is slightly higher than what was set.
Josiane, sorry, I have to interrupt you. We don't see your presentation.
You don't see my presentation?
Maybe you have forgotten to share it.
You can share. You can share.
Share screen. I'm so sorry. I thought I was sharing.
Okay. Now we see it.
Yeah, yes. Okay.
Very nice.
Yes. Okay, good. So yeah, that was the slide of the introduction. And when I was talking about reducing waste, and here about the temperature and the breathing of the products. So here we see that the product is using oxygen, expulsing CO2, losing water, producing heat, and will be also affected by ethylene. My colleague Hans de Wild will talk in more detail of those about those subjects. So what I was saying here, the first picture on the top left, it's an example of heat production in the cold storage, even though the cold storage is set at a very low temperature. Due to the breathing process, it is a bit higher than the settings in the cold storage. The second picture in the middle, there's an example of shriveling on the apples due to water loss. And the one on the right, the ripeness will continue after harvest until senescence and eventually the death of the product. Here we see the beans are starting changing color. If the product is breathing, then it also means that it can choke. So by reducing the oxygen level, we extend their shelves, their storage time. But if we decrease it too low, we can have the product can lack oxygen. It can overheat. It can suffer from hypothermic, that's or chilling injury, or get affected by diseases. And the last two examples are the physical damage, and here in this picture, in the middle down, we see an affected apple that the infection entered due to a physical damage. And lastly, the mechanical damage, here we see a sun while picking a nail that got into the fruit and the wound just wasn't afterwards. Unfortunately, according to the FAO, 1/3 of the food produced is lost or wasted. Where in some regions of the world, food is mainly lost during the processing and distribution part of the supply chain, in other parts of the world, the losses are occurring at the consumption level, as we can see in this diagram. But luckily, we are living at a time where improvements will bring big changes, where the return on investment in post-harvest technology can reach 1 to 14, meaning that for every $1 invested, there's a possible return of $14 to the company. It will make a difference for your business, but also for food security, as we will have to feed 1 billion more people within a few decades. Food loss and waste cost the global economy $940 billion every year. And if food loss and waste would be a country, it would generate so much CO2 a year that it will be the third largest emitter of CO2 in the world. Well, do you want to be part of this improvement? Well, I do, and this is why I do what I do. And that I'm thrilled to be here today in front of you. When I click, it goes too fast. Okay, my name is Josiane Cloutier, like Robert said. I'm French-Canadian living in the Netherlands. I'm a post-harvest consultant and a researcher and I have 10 years of working experience in the agricultural sector, from the open fields to greenhouses and from supply chain to international trade. Hans and I were working at Wageningen Research. That's a part of the university, and it's the global number one of agri-food in the Netherlands. And there's 45% of the graduates students are from abroad, representing more than 100 nations, which I'm part of. And you have to keep in mind that it's all happening in a small town of 40,000 people. And the strength of Wageningen University and research is that it is composed of two parts. Eh? The university with more than 12,000 students and 4,000 publications a year. And there's a research center where I work. That's a contract research where applied and pre-competitive research is done. We work with companies to develop patents and licenses. And one of the departments is the post-harvest technology department for fresh and for fresh food. My former colleague started during the previous century with refrigeration technology, and later on with a wave of technology came like packaging. And we did a lot of work with ethylene and controlled atmosphere and sensing technology. And more recently, we are working with artificial intelligence and data to improve logistics. And of course, all those subjects are still actual, and improvements is still to be needed. And why are we working so hard? Well, we want to go from the current situation where a fresh product has to fit in a certain specification, leading to losses, and that is fighting against nature. Nature, which provides us with fruits and vegetables of different shapes and ripening rapidity. And the ripening rapidity is one of the challenges in post-harvest management. And on top of this, farmers get lower prices for their outclassed products, leading to even more pressure on the supply chain. So we aim to perfectly match the quality of fresh produce to consumer demands and preferences in a super sustainable way. Here is a representation of the entire food supply chain from the production to the consumption. Losses are encountered at every step because of structural or economic, technological or behavior issues, inflexible procedures, or simply the poor synchronization between the supply and the demand. And at our institute, we have started to measure the food loss and waste during the entire chain. It has become more clear where and especially why food is lost. And then we focus on the chain from the harvest moment, and that is the post-harvest chain. We give advice on when and how to harvest and how to store or to use packaging. We work to the consumption from the retail to the households to upcycle waste. And here is the where the measurements has been done already. That's the dark purple color. And the light purple color represents the measurements that are still to be completed, still going on. And as you can see, there's still a lot of work to do, because once we measure it, then we can better tackle it and address the problem. So now I want to go back to my first question, and the title of this talk, because it's a big question, so it requires a big answer. So I will answer that in different steps. Going from the product to the data here. So we address we tackle the problem from the product by doing measurements in post-harvest to understand the quality and try to predict the quality. In a minute, I will give you some more examples of that. We look at the technology, how to preserve the product quality by controlling the post-harvest environment. We look at the logistics, so how to improve the decision making in the supply chain. And we look at the whole system, to how to fulfill the consumer needs and still have a good supply chain. And all those steps are using or generating data. And so how can we make good use of those data? That's also one of the challenges and subject that we tackle. So going back to the first subject that I presented you, we work a lot with fresh food and vegetable companies or tech companies to look at their ripening process or to breed for post-harvest quality, to develop sensors for non-invasive quality measurements so that every fruit can be measured without being lost and be properly classified. And we also offer consultancy. Here it's an example that mango had to be cut in order to check the ripening stage, the internal stage, but that's what we want to avoid. The second subject that I have previously shown in the circle is the quality control during storage and transport. And we work a lot with storage and transport companies, and once again with fresh foods and vegetables companies. We look at dynamic control climate, so how to improve that. We have a project right now looking at how to reduce the CO2 production and saving money by going totally off-grid, and how to use the data of the cold store in a more efficient way. If we look at quality-driven logistics, it's mostly supply chain owners that do that type of projects. And some example of topics that we did are the fresh e-commerce for the measurements of the cold box during transport. We also looked at plastic-free supply chains with a cooling and misting system, as we see here. And it has been implemented in the Netherlands by some retailers. So that's also save in labor time because the products do not need to be put back in the cold storage for the night. So they get misted and it cools them down enough to stay there overnight. We also looked at adaptive and intelligent packaging. This project is also still going on to be further improved. It's made of potato starch, and according to the external conditions, it allows the fruits to stay fresh. And in this case, the tests were done at 8 and 18 degrees, and the pears stayed much fresher than the conventional packaging. And last one, to make an example of more circularity in agriculture, this packaging here, the box of the tomatoes, was made of old plants, tomato plants. So we can harvest the tomato plants at the end of the growing season and make the boxes in which the tomatoes will be put the next year. And then there's the food system design, and that's at more at the government level and supply chain level, because this has to be well organized, I mean, on a larger scale. And we look at future food supply and how we will keep on feeding the cities and thinking local but acting global. So this is more in a visionary access to the situation. And finally, what I said about data and artificial intelligence, then we look at the whole supply chain, and that those data helps us to predict the quality, to give also more transparency in the chain, allowing, for example, the farmer to keep ownership of their product, but also because the chain is more transparent, to reduce the losses in the chain, to improve the decision making at the same time, and to build up a history of data. But here it's a diagram showing how new knowledge can be implemented and how we do it. And I think this is the great advantage of the Wageningen University, is the way we work from fundamental to applied to the implementation in order to have an impact. The fundamental research is used as base for the applied research, so what Hans and I are doing, and for this demonstration in the industry, followed by the implementation of new technology. And this way the knowledge is developed where the market needs it to get results. For example, last year we worked on developing a new packaging for an international company, and that packaging was better recyclable. So we really worked near the implementation here with them. So to answer their questions. And that is necessary because food loss and waste is a complicated situation because it is a global challenge. There are some structural issues to technological issues or management and behavior issues. It's difficult to tackle in one direction, and all leading to loss in quality of the product and waste. And this is why we need to work together to achieve this. And as you can see on this diagram, in order to reach the food production by 2050, we need to reduce food loss and waste. And I hope we can do it together on innovations helping reduce food losses across the agri-food chain. So that was it for me today. I hope you enjoyed my presentation. Sorry for the technical error at the beginning. I hope I can answer your questions. And after me, my colleague will show more concrete examples in post-harvest management. I don't see the box of questions. Maybe if I stop sharing, I will see it.
Well, thank you, Josiane. We will take care of the questions if they arise, and otherwise you will get a few from me. Thank you very much for this interesting presentation. Just a second, please. As usual, the first question is that people would like to receive your presentation. Well, I can say that all the presentations today will be shared with all the participants and audience of this webinar.
Thank you.
So I have been listening with high interest to your presentation, and it was very clear how you illustrated the increasing complexity of the food supply chain and the contribution of that increasing complexity to the problem of food losses. We have seen that the food supply chains worldwide get longer, they get part of international trade, the scale of production has increased, environmental concerns are coming in, health concerns and the need for fresh products have been increasingly important in food supply chains, as well as the diversity of products. All these things makes the whole food system more complex and also give rise to more occurrence of food loss and waste, and therefore science and technology and also need to step up and be innovative in order to address these problems that come along with the modernization. And that is what you clearly have presented in your presentation. I need to get some feedback now from my colleagues. Do I first go to the next presentation or do I first address questions? Oksana, can you tell me that?
Robert, there is one question in the question and answer box. You should be able to see it. It's from Samir Al-Badri.
Yeah. A question from one of the audience, Mr. Samir Al-Badri. Is there a mathematical model to extend the shelf life of fruits and vegetables, Josiane?
Yeah, we are working on it. It is quite complex because it will vary per cultivar of the product. So not only per product, but also per cultivar, and also depending on the growing season. We are working on it. We also have an application to per cultivar apple and pears to know exactly how to put them in the cold storage. So it's not a mathematical model yet, but that's certainly something that's under a process. But what we already offer are application with a detailed storage advice. I hope that answers your question.
And I okay. Yeah. Then the next question that I see here is to be concrete, we need to from Sophie Treinen, we need to react and embed the changes in the food supply chain. So how is Wageningen University and their research program practically embedding these changes into projects and in food supply chains?
We have several projects, and we do them with companies. It's implemented. There's a lot that are confidential at that moment. But what I can say, there's one we worked on pears. The project is called Humistatus. To predict the pear ripening process to reduce waste after the harvest. We also work on a project called Fresh on Demand that's including supermarkets and companies to look at reducing waste on different approach, for example, with different type of packaging, and also better recyclable packaging or biodegradable packaging. There is a other project that we do. It's called breeding for post-harvest. So how can we tackle the problem from the genetics? So before the product is even grown, so that the tomatoes, for example, will be able to stay longer on the shelf, or that the flowers will stay more beautiful for a longer time from their genetics. So those are a few examples that I can think of right now.
Okay, then we have a question from Nechati Simsekli. Sorry if I don't pronounce it well, but it's written in Turkish, so I'm asking the translator to read out the question into English, if you can see it.
I put it in Google Translate because I don't hear the translator. The question is the most important issue you have identified so far in the food industry is waste or quality? Thank you. It's a very good question. Actually, it's how to measure or how to predict quality that's the biggest challenge, because from the moment that we know how a product will react and how long we have to process it or to put in the supply chain, then we can make a better decision. So from the moment of the harvest, we have to be clear. From the moment of the harvest, we cannot make a product better than what it is. We can only preserve the quality. So it's important to reach the best quality we can during growth of the product. And from the harvest, our job is to preserve the quality. Like one of my colleagues is saying, the post-harvest management is not a hospital. I would say the answer is a mix of the two. By knowing the quality and be able to predict the quality, we can reduce waste.
All right, then I see a question from Guljahan Kurbanova. The question is, what are main innovation approaches in reducing food losses and waste at different stages of the food supply chain for sustainability of food systems? And what may you recommend for other countries? Now, I would like to say that this question is very broad. It is a very rightful question, but it is very broad. And it covers actually the presentations that we are going to have following this very morning, plus a number of webinars that we organize later in the year, because you are asking about food loss and waste all along the whole food supply chain and what can be recommended for different countries. So I would like to ask you, Guljahan, to hold on with your question and to await the coming presentations and see if the answers are still provided, and otherwise they will follow up in the next webinars. Otherwise, the response will be a webinar on its own. The question from Robert Pranche, in international supply chains, what are the weak links? Josiane, maybe you can answer the question with regards to the post-harvest segment of the supply chain in international context. Yeah. What would you call the weak spots of the post-harvest sector? With regard to international supply chains?
We have to put into context that food has been transported at sea, for example, in big ships and indoor ships. There is not only fresh products. So the transporters his main interest is to reach destination at the right time. But it's not necessarily to get those peaches at the right temperature or the right oxygen level, because he also transports a bunch of other stuff. So the weakest point would be also in the transfer between different means of transportation. So when we switch from truck and then we arrive at the harbor, and then there's a lap of time that the product has to wait until it's been put on the boat, and of course they do it as fast as possible, because if they can put more products, then it's more efficient. But in that lapse, it can be a few hours or it can be a few days, the conditions are not always maintained. So by the change of mean of transportation, theirs are the weakest point, I think. Because they don't only work with fresh products. Also, in some countries, we are talking about that the product is changed from containers, literally from boxes or containers, and that can where bruising can occur, for example, or a physical injury. So it's a complex chain, and to summarize, when we change from a stakeholder in the chain or physically from one means of transport to another, there's a risk that the cold chain will be broken, and therefore the product will decay.
Okay. The next question is from Abhinya Reddy Verimala from India. And it is, do we have any low-cost post-harvest equipment available in India? Now, this is, of course, a very rightful and practical question. And I can imagine, Eugene, that you don't have the answer right away, but maybe we can provide this information to Verimala at the later stage. Eugene, do you have any?
Yeah, because it's a very broad answer. That could be a whole seminar in itself. I did a few projects in India.
Look at that. So you are experienced there.
I mean, I'm less experienced than in the years, but I've been there a few times. But it's once again the communication between the different skilled holders is not as transparent in other parts of the world, and there's a reason that it's this way. The fact that it's the information is not transparent, there's a lot of the cold chain is not maintained, for example, or boxes needs to be changed several times before the product reached the end. So this question is not only solved by putting a low cost equipment in post harvest, but we have to tackle it also from a communication point of view in the whole supply chain, because if we just say, oh, we can put a cheap cold store and to keep your products, but then there's a whole there's a whole infrastructure around the cold store and the communication that needs to be put in place, because right now the chain is really non-transparent. So it's very difficult to put the logistic more efficiently to reduce waste. But that's a very good question that will deserves more attention. Thank you, Abhinya, for your question.
We will get back on this with another response. Otherwise, you can always contact us. Either Eugene or myself at FEO with specific questions, which we then can answer by email. There is a question from Richard Thompson. To what extent can conventional plastic used in packaging be replaced by bio-based materials? And what are the impacts on the packaging's performance for reducing food loss?
Very good question, also very broad. The conventional plastic is very practical, very cheap, but the challenge is that there are so many types of it, and to recycle it is difficult if there is a recycle facility around. So that's a pity, because otherwise it's a good way to keep the product fresher longer. But the bio-based materials, the positive impact is that, well, the name says it ends from organic material, so we could compost it. We don't need to separate the different type of bio-based material. They will all be composted. And right now, those bio-based materials are developed so that they would be at least as good as the conventional plastic or better. Like the one that I explained with the tomato, the potato starch, that the fruit could be, if the cold chain is broken, the fruits was better maintained if we change the temperature from 8 to 18 and to 8 again, then a conventional plastic. So I hope that answer your question.
Then a question from Daniele Fatibene. Are there any relevant examples of regulatory or policy developments taking place at European level to reduce post-harvest losses, which you are monitoring in your research?
This is personally not my topic of research. It's more my colleagues. So I don't have the answer right now. I would say there's probably relevant regulations and policy under development, but I don't have any example right now. But I can get in touch with the right colleague and give the answer.
Okay, next one. I'm really very happy and impressed by the long list of questions and the variety of the topics, as well as the diversity of the people asking them. Now I'm getting a question from Ahmad Al-Kraisat. He is asking, if I were to receive import of new fruits species in the country, and upon arrival the whole lot was diseased, what steps do I take to diagnose and solve the problem? Is there a general procedure or scheme followed for post-harvest management to identify the cause of the unknown disease?
What step that can be done is send a sample to a lab, to can be our lab, for example, or another company, a more nearby
food lab.
Otherwise, it will decay even further near where you are, and to identify what got the product rotten. Also, to identify when it could have happened. Is it because the transport was not done under the right temperature where the product decayed? Or was it a fungi, for example, that was there before it entered the transport container, and then it further developed during the transport? So that's really important to identify when and what happened. And once that is identified, if it's a fungi that happened in pre-storage, then there's something that needs to be addressed in the pre-harvest phase. But if it's during transport, then we can look at the conditions of the transportation, if it was done according to the protocol, the standard operation and procedures. And if not, then we have to look at the contract, who has the ownership of the fruit to tackle the problem. I hope that answered your question.
The next one is a really challenging question, Georgiana. So if you need any help in answering it, I would be available, but let me ask it to you. Could you comment on whether or not current international food supply chains are sustainable? If not, what are the areas that require immediate attention and focus? And the question is from Sarang Tambale.
That is a very interesting question. I ask myself that every week when I go to the supermarket. I allow myself to buy bananas from the other side of the world, but then I think, oh, kiwis, it's too far. So where do we put the line? And how can we buy more sustainably food? But that is, it's a very complex question. Because the apples in the Netherlands that we eat year round, they are stored and therefore use energy. What is the limit between the storage of the fruit that are grown locally or importing at once product? So we have to make the calculation of the CO2 production. It depends also how you see the sustainability, and do you see it as CO2 production or on pesticides, use land, water use, that's also very broad. But what I can say is that, so a few years ago, some of my colleagues, they looked at, for apples, how far the apples had to come from to make it less sustainable than locally grown apples that were kept in the cold storage. And the answer was roughly 400 kilometers. So if you buy apples further within 400 kilometers, it would be better in their calculation for that specific situation to buy locally. So that's a calculation that we need to make for different products. And there's another example that was calculated that for flowers, it would be more sustainable to make them come from Ethiopia to the Netherlands, for example, once, because you have one time a transport, then growing them locally, because locally then we have to heat up the greenhouse the year round. So it's a very complex and challenging question, and that's what I can say for now, but that deserves a lot of attention as well. Thank you very much.
All right, there are more questions, but I want to leave it now because we need to go to the next speaker. Yes. And since the next speaker, Mr. Hans de Wild, is from the same department in the Wageningen University as Josiane, and the topics are touching on each other, probably we can address some of the remaining questions after his presentation. Otherwise, as I said, we can always get back to the persons who asked the question later by email and answer them. So now I would like to introduce Hans de Wild, post-harvest consultant and researcher at Wageningen University and Research. And Hans will proceed with the presentation as was started by Josiane. Hans, please go ahead.
Thank you, Robert. I will share my screen. Just a moment. I hope I succeeded. Do you see my screen, Robert?
No, sorry, we don't see it yet.
I'll try again.
Now we see your screen, yes.
Yes, okay, like this.
Okay. Yes, please, just go to the right. Go to the right slides.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, good day. Welcome to this part of the webinar. Thanks for joining, and we also want to thank the FAO for giving us this opportunity to discuss this important and interesting subject. My goal of today is to present to you various practical measures for reduction of post-harvest losses. I give you some practical examples and tips about improvement of harvest practice, improvement of post-harvest management, the importance of quality monitoring, and technical checks. I'd like to quickly introduce myself. I'm Hans de Wild from Wageningen University and Research. And Wageningen is also the place where I studied horticulture. And I worked as a scientific researcher, which resulted in my PhD title in biology. Then between 2007 and 2018, I worked in the industry as an R&D technical manager for the company AgroFresh. And then I found the right combination of being both consultant and researcher in post-harvest in my current function. My expertise is harvest and storage recommendations, advanced post-harvest technologies, post-harvest physiology, ethylene, and 1-MCP. In this presentation, I will discuss these three key points. First, I will present about the harvest and initial handling, which includes temperature management, materials, harvest maturity, picking, and transport. Then I'll share with you some experiences from storage, including the storage conditions, cooling, moisture loss, ethylene, oxygen, and CO2. And I want to emphasize the importance of quality monitoring and checks. And finally, I will summarize it in the conclusions. First, harvest and initial handling. I like to see this kind of activities as you see now on the screen. There is a fresh harvest product coming in, clean, good field crates, nicely stacked. Only concern at this moment is when will this reach the cold store? When will this product start with cooling down? And that brings us to temperature management. This is here a situation from practice with freshly harvested melons waiting to be transported in the field, waiting to be transported to the pack house. And here we look at the graph. Take the pointer. Here we look at the graph. It's about the melon internal temperature. And you see early in the morning, 11 past 9, the temperature of the melons is somewhere between 32 degrees already, depending on a bit on the, well, it's the in the bottom of the load or on the top of the load. And then about each 15 minutes, there's an increase in temperature of about 1 degree. And that shows how fast something like this can go. And it also means that these melons will bring an extra heat load when they enter the storage room. So it will take a considerable time again to cool down in the storage room to the optimum cold temperature. And in addition to the higher energy cost and the delays in logistics, this will have a direct impact on quality. Another point of attention are the materials. They should be suitable and sufficient for the harvesters. And at the beginning of harvest, the materials, etc., they are almost enough and they are clean, but this should remain the case during the total harvest period. Like field bins, crates, trays should not be broken, not contain sharp edges because it can damage the product and must be clean. Workers must be equipped with appropriate work equipment, such as gloves, sharp harvest scissors, and maturity charts. The maturity at harvest. Is a very important part of the total chain because it can have consequences of the quality later in the chain. The harvest must be well planned in order not to harvest too undermature or overmature. It is important to consider the market needs and requirements in order to harvest on time. A good labor planning is necessary. And the training of pickers, instruction of what they should pick is also very important. And I want to illustrate these three, four points with these two photos of the apples. Can you see the differences between the two photos? On the left, you see this, still these two wet, most wet apples. And on the right picture, they have been picked. So this is an example of having multiple picks. It means that the amount of apples picked under or over mature will be much less. It means the market gets more equal product. Labor planning, of course, it will take extra labor to make an extra harvest round, but that probably pays back in more kilograms and a better size and color of the remaining apples. And of course, trainers should be, or the pickers should be trained well in which product they should harvest, whether it's apple or maturity stage of the plum or the color of the tomato. For determining this maturity levels, there are several methods like sugar content or color, taste, starch, firmness. My message is here, please use them. Use them the right way. Write down the measurement, take photos, and learn from the data. That is so important also for the next crop to be harvested, to learn from your own experiences. Once a product is then ready to harvest, of course, it should be done carefully, regardless of the crop. Here are some examples of what we see in practice. The point is that incorrect handling may not show to the harvester yet, but may show up only later in the chain. And the harvester awareness of this is important. For instance, when a fruit like this is picked without a stem, it's not only cosmetic damage, but it can also lead to more decay later in the chain. We must make sure that the harvest crew understands that such an apple can cause major problems later on. Also a broken stem, a bruises, bins being overfilled, or small injuries. These may not seem serious at harvest, but they can cause severe losses later in the chain. Another point of attention at harvest is the prevention of contamination. One advice that I can give here is to separate diseased fruit from healthy fruit already in the field, if possible. And this may be done, for instance, by using an extra crate, as you see here, for the apples. So damaged apples during harvest are collected in a separate crate. And the same example you can see here for the strawberries, where an extra crate is placed on top of the trolley where diseased strawberries are collected in. Transport is also a very important part of the total post-harvest chain. It's not only from the field to the packhouse, but also from the packhouse to destination by truck, by reefer container, or plane even. Pay attention to temperature management. Temperature is very important. Ventilation and circulation can depend on the commodity or even variety. Suitable packaging to protect the quality of the product against damages. Careful stacking, careful driving. And for that one, careful driving, sometimes drivers may need training how to load and handle horticulture produce, because horticultural fresh produce is clearly different from, for instance, canned or frozen food. Then the second part of my presentation, I want to focus on storage and some of our experiences here. Factors we control in storage are temperature, humidity, oxygen and CO2, and ethylene. And in this process of storage, the quality checks and technical checks points. An optimal temperature is usually the first requirement to maintain a good quality for the horticultural produce. It prolongs the storage life and preserves the quality in several aspects by slowing down ripening and senescence, by slowing down the development of pathogens, and also by reducing water loss by the products, preventing issues like shriveling and wilting. Pre-cooling is a method being used to remove the field heat when the product comes from the field into the storage. Keeping a good quality of fruit and vegetables, also ornamentals in the cold chain. When the produce is simply placed inside a room, then the cooling of the produce can be slow. There are several pre-cooling systems available to bring down the temperature of the product much faster, like vacuum cooling, hydrocooling, and the use of ice. Also forced air cooling. The forced air cooling is the most widely used method of pre-cooling, and I will go a little bit more. Best known are these tunnel type fixed units, where a fan is housed inside the wall of a cold storage room. And this fan is used to drive the cool air through the load within a refrigerated room. You have these canvas or polyethylene sheets. They are rolled over the top of the load down to the floor. And this forces the cold air through the fence of the packaging and giving a faster temperature decrease for the product. So this is an effective method of cooling down fresh products quickly. You see some indication given here on the screen. But as post-harvest consultant, we often see these nice systems, but they are often not used optimally. A good design of the packaging of ventilation holes in the packaging is necessary to provide an effective and uniform cooling. Then the stacking of the boxes or packages, they must be carried out in such a way that the openings and the stacking is that way that the airflow goes to it and follows the right path. More often than thought, the airflow does not follow the intended path to the stack. Instead, it follows a much shorter path than intended. And this can be prevented by using materials like foam or cardboard pieces to block this short circuit of air. And this peak cooling should be monitored well, to ensure that the cooling is achieved in the most efficient way. So if you are using these systems, measure the temperature at several points in the stack and look for improvements. Something about trucks and reefers, reefer containers. Refrigerated trucks and reefer containers do not have sufficient cooling capacity to lower the product temperature a lot. It means that the fresh product must be pre-cooled before it enters a refrigerated truck or a reefer. For temperature, we can distinguish between air and product temperature. And air temperature is often measured, but the importance of measuring also the internal product temperature, that's often underestimated. Within a room, there will be differences. It is important to have temperature measurement at the
It seems we have lost Hans, the connection with Hans.
Yes, I also don't have Hans, and also I don't see Josiane or.
Yeah, Josiane is there.
Josiane is there. Okay.
Yeah, I'm here. Shall I call him?
You could, or probably he's trying to reconnect. We could maybe use this time to address the remaining questions while we are waiting, or let's give him a few minutes.
Yeah, let's first try to understand what happens, and then we can see if you need to fill in the time.
Okay, I just mentioned via WhatsApp that we don't hear him anymore.
We don't see him either.
Yeah, so. I don't have an answer, so he's probably busy trying to reconnect.
Maybe it would indeed be a good that Josiane, if you can answer the next question that you have received.
The next question
I can read it.
I would like to learn whether there are good food recovery and redistribution practices in countries that you monitor in your research.
Yeah, it's from Qushi Yui.
Oh yeah, that we answered already, right?
No, we didn't.
No, this was not.
Sorry. Well, recovery, I don't know. What he means exactly by recovery, because recovery
means that you get back products from the food supply chain, products which are at risk to get lost or wasted, because they are reaching ultimate maturity or expiry dates, etc.
Yeah, but that needs then a good communication between the scale stakeholder. So a clear supply chain, a transparent supply chain. So once that's in place, that's possible to do so.
The question is, if you apply that, if you're doing research to that, if that is part of your research program.
Yeah, some colleagues focus only on that. So if he wants more information on this more specifically, I can get him or her in touch with the right people within the university. Yeah.
Okay, then the next question was from Haitham Hamdan. As mentioned, and well known that cold chain management is the key factor in control and keep product quality for a long time. How can we benefit efficiently from solar energy in that matter in an affordable way on all value chain steps? Now let's particularly focus on the post-harvest value chain step for now, okay? Yeah. So the use of solar energy in order to keep the cold chain alive.
We have one project that's for the moment confidential, but we are working on it. So as soon as it's not confidential anymore, then I will be able to say more about it. But what is already known is that we can make the use of batteries to store the energy. But currently we are working in another system without batteries or much less. I would say with the use of batteries, we can achieve that.
I trust that the confidentiality has nothing to do with politics and so on, but that is rather scientific.
No, it's because we, maybe I should clarify that. It's because we work a lot with companies. So they want to keep their results for themselves for a little bit so that they are able to implement what they invested in before competitors are jumping on the knowledge. This is the only reason why.
Okay, in the meantime, I've seen that Hans has joined us again.
Yeah.
Hans,
yes, I'm sorry.
What happened, and can you continue?
I don't know what happened, but I try to continue.
Yeah. You have to share the screen again then, right?
Yes. Okay, is it okay, Robert?
Yes, you're back.
Not sure where we lost connection. I think it's somewhere here about the importance of temperature. Maybe I'll repeat something with temperature so important. So that's actually a good slide to repeat maybe. We can distinguish between air and product temperature. And air temperature is often measured, but we should not forget about the internal product temperature. And the importance of measuring the product temperature is often underestimated. When we measure inside the storage room, it's important to measure at different spots, including also the coldest and warmest place, at least. When you're using equipment, temperature sensors, of course, it should be accurate. Because if not, it can lead to serious consequences if the product is not stored at the right temperature, which can lead to losses in part of the rooms or even complete rooms. A zero check of the sensors is mostly done by the supplier, but because of its importance, I also recommend for each storage manager also to check it yourself. It can be done in melting ice water, like for example, you see on the photo, melting ice water in an isolated can. And while doing this check, you need to stare the sensor, and then it should give a temperature of 0.0 degrees. Besides fixed temperature sensors in the room, I recommend not only trust on them, but also have a hand temperature control available to do regular checks yourself. More about temperature. How to optimize it. And one way is optimize by having a good maintenance and cleaning of your cooling equipment. Because dirty coolers have less performance. It means they have to cool for longer cooling periods. It consequently leads to more drying of the air and consequently more moisture loss from the products. It also means when the cooling time per day is longer, there will be more heat input to the fan motors. And this temperature also has to be cooled down again, which also means a higher energy consumption. Another way to optimize the temperature conditions inside the room is to optimize the air circulation. Make sure that the air circulation is similar in the entire cold room and prevent false airflows. We have here an example. It's a partially filled room with a stack of 9 bins high. And we've measured the airflow at different positions in this room. And based on these measurements, measuring the airflows, we improved the temperature control in this room by improved use of these sails, and also by blocking some areas, in this case between bins and walls, to prevent a false airflow. And by these measures, we see a more equal air circulation throughout all bins, which also means a more equal temperature. So an optimal temperature is mostly the first requirement to maintain a good quality of horticultural produce. Humidity is the second condition of importance in storage rooms. And the relative humidity in storage rooms can have various effects on quality. Swiveling and wilting are well known. They are the consequence of moisture loss from the fresh produce to the drier environment. And moisture loss or water loss also means a loss of saleable weight. Sometimes some water loss is necessary to prevent physiological disorders like internal browning and apple pears, or to prevent fungal attacks. This also varies again per commodity and even per variety. And the table you see on the screen shows some examples for the long-term storage of apples and pears. You see already the different recommendation for the storage temperature, but there's also a recommendation for the percentage water loss per month for long-term storage. There's not only a maximum to prevent swiveling, but there's also a minimum to prevent certain internal disorders and prevent certain forms of decay. Like this table, it's based on extensive research and also practical experience before we come up with these exact numbers. Low oxygen and high CO2, they are applied in controlled atmosphere or CA storage. Yes, not only the final settings that are important, but also clear protocols are needed about how to reach these final conditions. Think about the exact time between harvest and the start of these conditions. And the speed of the oxygen reduction. How fast should it actually go? And we see, especially in the storage of apples, also strong development to even very low oxygen conditions in the dynamic controlled atmosphere, the TCA. We've recently at Wagen developed a storage tool for apples and pears, and also this based on research and practical experiences. It's an application that can be used on the phone as an app or on the PC. And it describes per variety, pear or apple, the exact recommended protocol for the best storage conditions in detail. And we believe that the availability of this material in detail contributes to a better quality and thereby less losses. You see that besides temperature, CO2, oxygen, and recommendations for moisture loss, it also contains a recommendation for 1-MCP, which is an ethylene inhibitor. It brings me to the next slide about ethylene, also an important point in storage. It's also called the ripening or senescence hormone. It's very relevant for the ripening of many food species. Most foods produce ethylene to start the ripening process, and sometimes it can also be seen as positive for the taste and to ripen the product. Ethylene is even artificially supplied in ripening rooms, for instance, banana or mango or avocado. However, in many cases, the presence of ethylene is undesirable. It limits the storage time when fruit ripe too quickly and becomes overripe. This group includes products like apple, apricot, pear, plum, and tomato. Ethylene can also cause problems for produce where ripening does not play a role. It can activate the senescence process in sensitive vegetables. Think about green beans, cabbage, lettuce, broccoli, carrots, plant stock. Ethylene is also one of the air conditions that we actually can control with practical interventions, if necessary. The presence of high ethylene can indeed affect quality and lead to suboptimal application of practical solutions. And when there are negative effects of ethylene are suspected, it will be good to measure and to take the right actions. For example, in the context of our advisory work, we examined the concerns expressed by a European distributor of fruits and vegetables. They had expressed the concerns about a certain distribution location, about a certain room. And we went there to check the ethylene concentration during a period of 1 week. You see the ethylene in the graph, there's a large variation. There can be several reasons for that. There will be a difference during that week in the existing commodities and volumes in the room. There can be a difference in ripeness of the products. There can be a difference in storage conditions like temperature and fluctuation in air change by door openings or ventilations. What's important here is the ethylene level. You see it's always above 1000 ppb, that's 1 ppm, and several days even above 2000 ppb. And this level is significantly higher than recommended for ethylene sensitive products. It means it can have a negative impact on quality. For this location in particular, we have advised to first check the air outlet of adjacent banana ripening rooms because a possible contamination of ethylene was coming from that site. And a further strategy here was to increase the ventilation with fresh ethylene pour air. A summary of practical solutions to reduce loss by ethylene is given here. Cooling at cold temperature, again, important. Avoid excessive ethylene from external sources. That can be ripening food, but can also be exhaust fumes from cars or from gas forklifts. Ventilation with fresh ethylene, poor ethylene-free air. That's often quite, let's say, simple measure to do. Then there are ethylene removers or converters on the market, for instance, in kiwifruit rooms. Reduction of oxygen, elevated CO2 in CA storage rooms will help. And you may be familiar with inhibition of ethylene action by ethylene antagonist 1-MCP. Bit more about that. So 1-MCP is applied in storage rooms. And it inhibits the ethylene action and therefore leads to a better quality in the storage room, but also later in the chain. And when this technology is applied correctly, it can indeed have several advantages for quality. We use our knowledge and measurements of ethylene to optimize this and to understand the 1-MCP effect. And what we see in practice, in our experience, is that often it goes well, but some cases this practical application can still be improved. Some last points I want to share with you. It's about the high importance of quality checks and monitoring. If a quality problem is found, it's so important to identify the symptoms and then find the cause of the problem. Is the product immature? Is it too ripe? Maybe it's a consequence of water loss, too less or too much. Do you see a problem with mechanical damage? What can be the cause of that? Is there a physiological disorder, maybe related to temperature? Or can we relate it back to, for instance, pests? And only if this question is answered, then appropriate measures can be taken to avoid losses for subsequent crops. Technical checks also provide a wealth of information. We love the monitoring and measure what actually happens in storage rooms, such as analyzing this graph with one-day cooling actions in a fruit storage room, or measuring the temperature by use of temperature loggers in the total supply chain. And this brings me almost to the end of this presentation, but I want to summarize the conclusions. It all begins with a good start quality. So pay attention to harvest maturity and reduction of mechanical injury at that part of the chain. Temperature and time, these are the key factors in the post-harvest supply chain. Humidity is important. Control of moisture depends on the commodity. Oxygen and CO2. These optimal conditions for oxygen and CO2, they must be chosen, but always in combination with a good cold storage. Ethylene management is important for a number of products. Knowledge. farmers and storage managers, they must have sufficient knowledge about the products, and they should also not hesitate to ask for advice or ask for training. And then the quality checks and technical checks, they are, in my view, so important to develop better protocols. And these points will bring both economical advantages and reduction of food losses. Thank you very much for your attention. Don't hesitate to contact us via email or LinkedIn. And on LinkedIn, we also publish regularly publications with practical advice, which can be of interest to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Hans de Wild, for this elaborate, highly interesting presentation. Unfortunately, because of the time that we lost, I would suggest that now we skip the questions and answers that resulted from your presentation, and maybe after the at the end of the seminar, at the webinar, maybe there's some time still to address a few. I just would like to make one remark about your presentation, where you in your presentation you showed quite a high number of technology solutions to reduce food losses and to improve the post-harvest practices with regard to packaging, transportation, storage and cold storage, and treatment of products, etc., as well as harvesting techniques. And then you had the final remark that indeed, if it's all implemented well, you will definitely have reduced food losses, and that has an economic advantage. And that is where the trick comes in. Because what you indicated, these are all actions of good manufacturing practices, the common quality management tool of good manufacturing practices. But also applying these improved technologies comes with a cost. And you will see often in the food industry that the business operator has to make a decision. What is more expensive? Applying good manufacturing practices and the technologies, as you have indicated, or accepting that maybe 10% of my products gets lost or wasted. And if the loss is cheaper than the solution to reduce the loss, the manufacturer might easily choose for accepting the loss. So that's then an economic consideration. But we have to take into account that in the long run, always applying good manufacturing practices, increasing your quality of your operations and reducing losses, in the end, it will pay off. But it is sometimes difficult to convince the industry operators of this factor. So, and that makes the whole problem of food loss and waste so extremely complicated and difficult to tackle. That is why it hasn't gone away yet. So, okay, then we go to the next speaker. Just a second. The next speaker is Mr. Anatoly Fala, Program Director of the National Agency for Rural Development of the Republic of Moldova. This national agency, the acronym is ACSA, is a non-governmental, non-profit and non-political organization that carries out its activities throughout the entire territory of Moldova. And the mission of the agency is sustainable development of rural communities by setting up and developing professional network of information, consultancy and training of service providers for agricultural producers and rural entrepreneurs. Mr. Fala is going to give us an insight in a project that ACSA has implemented with regard to berries in Moldova. Mr. Fala, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much for my presentation, Robert. It's a good opportunity for us for discussion about the food loss. And also I will show my presentation and present a short information about one project we implemented here in Moldova for Moldavian farmers. Why in the berry sector? in the dairy sector, because in Moldova it's a big number of the farmers and small pieces of the land. For obtained good revenue for the farmers, big number of the small farmers and also the younger farmers decide to develop business in this area, in berry crops. We have increase of the area of berry during of the 5 years of 50%. Small introducing about the short status of the berry chain in Republic of Moldova. We have a good tradition for cultivation and also for consumption of this product. But the soil condition and also the climate change have not a good they have a very strong reduction of the quality and also of the quantity of this product. Good results we have for growing the berry in the north and center part of the Republic of Moldova. Why? Because we have a good soil condition and also less or more rainfall precipitation, 400 millimeters. It's not very enough for obtain the good yield. But I first of all, I described for the farmers, it's very important to obtain a good yield and also obtain high value products who have a possibility to buy on the local market and also for export. The structure of the area for planting of the berry crops in the Republic of Moldova, we have only three crops. This a more big area for production. This is a strawberry, a raspberry, and the currant, and special this is black currant, and also niche crops such as grassberry, blackberry, blueberry, cornelian, cherry, goji, and barrier. Why we decided to develop this activity for our farm? Because we have a loss of quantity of the and quality of the berry, in particular for the small farmers, because they didn't have a possibility to associate and make together and load of berry, for example, for export. The principal gaps, where are the gaps of the Moldavian berry chain? First, this is a planting material. You know, I think the participants know very well when the farmers own produce planting materials, it's a big probability to obtain not a virus-free plant materials. And the second problem, this is a lack of the variety for consecutive reapings. They make a conveyor for principal variety to obtain a longer period for make a good delivery and sale of the local market and on also for export. Third problem, this is the influence of climate change, the drought, high temperature, lack of humidity. And the other problem, this is the land is fragmented and pH of the soil, it's not the most favorable. Other problem, this is the cost of labor force. For example, for harvest berry, strawberry, the increase of the cost of final cost of the product of 25%. And for raspberry, it's 33-40% per 1 kilo. Also, we have a problem a little bit of internal market because the price it's not good when a big number of the farmers to propose and the same time the berry of the local market, they didn't have any facility for make a pre-cooling of these products. And after that, during of 48 hour, the quality of the strawberry, for example, or raspberry, it's not a good for obtain a good price of the local market and also for external or export market. How our project assurance this solve the problem for local farmers? First of all, we testing and introduce a new variety of different period of ripening, remontant varieties in comparison with the local seasonal varieties. For farmers change her variety and propose for local consumer and also for export good quality and test the fruit. For example, we have testing with one introduced variety LB1 in comparison of local variety, Corona or Marmalada. And also we provide other varieties, for example, Selva, Anadel, or Elba. It's a new variety who is introduced here in Moldova, and this variety in the moment distribute these planting materials for local nurseries, and they propose this variety for our farmers. Also, we introduce a new variety of raspberry to layman, of blackberry, Loch Ness, and for a red curran, Junker van der Tietz. Here on this slide, I propose for our attention what is comparative analysis of technological, productive, and economical characteristics of the variety who is introduced in Moldova in comparison with the local. Introduction of new variety, we have a possibility to decrease a loss of the yield and also to increase the quality. For example, a new variety who is introduced in Moldova, local for local market, our farmers have a possibility to buy this strawberry of local market on 1 euro and more for 1 kilo. For this reason, it's a good example for the farmers to change your conveyor of the soil, of the assortment of the variety and introduce a new variety to obtain growing of average of sale revenue per hectare or per small pieces of the land. Also, we promote introduction of those free planting materials and also micropropagate these planting materials in local condition with assurance pest and diseases control, because the pest is a vector of the diseases, and we promote IPM management of the nurseries and promote for the farmers to buy or to sell the planting materials only if they have certification of the planting materials. Also, we establish of demo plots for multiplication these planting materials with adaptation weather condition. For example, to use the shed net, use the irrigation system, and also mulching for farmers know a technological aspect and to reduce a loss of berry. Also very important for the farmers to explain the techniques for planting of planting materials, and also technological aspect for growing of the berry crops. Other problem who is resolved with our project is introducing of express test of pH of the soil for selecting of favorable soil condition for the future berry plantation. Our soil condition it's have a pH of 6.8, 7.4 of pH of the soil, but the normal condition for the berry, and special for a strawberry or a raspberry, blackberry, it's 5.2, 5.6. It's also we propose for the farmers to use some of amendments to assurance of pH of the soil. We also promote this technique for obtaining of healthy planting materials or introducing of new variety, new technological aspect, which promote and establish a farm field school. This is a good possibility of the farmers together to solve her problem with the facilitator or consultant of our National Extension Service. And also during of the field days, we promote new variety and new aspect of the technology for neighbors, farmers, for their assurance to use a new and new technological aspect in her production. This is a small presentation about the our project here in Moldova. At the moment, we have four nurseries who provide and make a multiplication of the planting materials of the this variety and propose for the farmers and healthy planting materials. Also, I will show the small video about our project here in Moldova. The first part of this video is about our problem. This is the problem of lack of healthy planting materials. Influence of the
Anatoly, very sorry to interrupt you, but since the time is up, I really would like to first go to the next presenter, and though regrettable, leave the video for what it is at the moment. We can always share the link with the participants at a later stage, if you don't mind. I'm very sorry for that, but everybody needs to have a fair share of the time to make his presentation. So I would say that your presentation clearly illustrated how all kinds of issues arising during production of fresh produce, of berries in this case, how they can result later on in the harvest and post-harvest phase to food losses. Because that is another thing that makes the problem of food losses so complicated. The food losses in one part of the supply chain can have a cause at a different part of the supply chain. For instance, if you have a problem with storage of berries, then the problem that food losses occur there during the storage phase, the problem is not always just the quality of the storage structure and the temperature and climate control in the storage structure. The problem can be that certain infectants or fungus have already set in the field. And if you select the right cultivation methods and you have the right varieties of the berries, like you have illustrated this in your presentation, that can prevent all kinds of problems to occur in the post-harvest phase and can reduce losses in the post-harvest phase as well. Then I have to go now to our last speaker of today, which is Mr. Blaže Josifovský. He is with IDE Macedonia, an NGO on food security projects in North Macedonia. Blaž, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Robert. So my name is Blaž Josifovský. I'm coming from the NGO Elizabeth Macedonia. So our main mission is to work on cutting the food losses and waste in our country. We are running a food surplus redistribution system, but also other projects that are there to cut the food losses and waste and help the livelihoods of different categories of citizens in our country. So when we were starting, we had a previous experience with this topic, but for us it was very important for the country to have a strategy that can follow in order to prevent and minimize the food losses and waste that are happening in the different value chains. So we were working together with FAO in order to make a strategy that is based on field research. And this was a long process that I'm going to also show. But the main point of this presentation is the good practices, but also the bad practices of food loss and waste, and how these bad and good practices are leading to food losses and waste. And I hope that maybe it will help some of you to implement this kind of activities in your country. So when we were starting, we needed to choose which of the value chains are we going to cover. Our main criteria were what is the quantities that this product is being produced by? What is the economical value of it for the livelihoods of the producers, but also generally the country? Also, what is the strategic position of that product for the country itself, the export value, and et cetera? And also how stable or unstable that value chain is and how much potentially it can produce food losses and waste. So we covered three types of vegetables and three types of fruits. As you can see, tomato, pepper, and cabbage. And we stationed ourselves directly in the region that is the biggest producers of these types of vegetables. And we chose three types of fruits that are the biggest, the people are producing the most in the country, and that's peach, plum, and apple. We were using methodology that is developed by the FAO team for food loss and waste. It was previously, I think, implemented only in Africa, and we were maybe one of the first that are implementing this kind of methodology in Macedonia. As you can see, we were serving, we were using surveys and sampling. We were interviewing all the different stakeholders in the different value chains. Then we were also sampling some of them in order if we were seeing some inconsistencies or if we were doubting certain stuff in the value chain. I chose specifically peppers and apples as a two examples. So peppers, according to the research at the end, show that it's the most stable system. And later on, I will show why and how good practices have made this system, made this value chain more stable than the others. And then I will show you the case of the apples in Macedonia that are, I mean, the most unstable system of all, unfortunately. Here you can see the case study for peppers. From the first side, you can see big numbers in different levels that we noticed. There is a huge qualitative and quantitative loss. This is showing that this, although this is the best, most stable value chain in the country, still there is huge space in order for it to be more sufficient, more effective, to have much less food loss and waste generating at different levels. I think, and I'll show you later, that good practice has actually helped to improve the pest management that farmers had, to improve how to actually prevent maybe even 20% of the products go and be lost, and actually those products are being used as in processing. That has helped a lot. Although we are still, according to us, there's a huge way in the processing part to cut a lot of the food loss and waste that occurs. But it's important, and you will see the numbers that are on producer level. The numbers are not so bad as the other value chains that we evaluated. And this is mainly because with the farmers. This is some of the pictures. You can see here how sorting is being done. Still, in many of the cases, still being done by hand, and as you can see in the pictures. In case of bad market or certain diseases or something else, injuries, still the farmers are just throwing out and creating piles of peppers and potentially burning it together with other waste. So there's a huge potential for improving. Then we are coming to apples. Those are the most produced fruit or vegetable in Macedonia. It has huge quantities. We can see here that there's on producer level, you can see that by harvesting, we examined that up to 6% is being lost because the harvesters, the pickers are not trained, they are not being monitored or controlled well as they should. There is storage loss on their level, and that's even up to 20%, and in many cases even more, just because they have insufficient storages that they're using, and then up to 20% being lost. There is huge opportunity there to be cut. And then there's other levels, industrial refuse and sorting and transport, where this can be improved. So there's in all levels there is opportunities for this to be improved. This is here some of the practices that we monitored. So generally, the field assessment showed us that there is like high incidence of food loss and waste. This is due to unmodernized production, still use the traditional way, Most of the people in the value chains in Macedonia, most of the farmers, 95% of the people that we interviewed are people above the age of 35, and not to say that they're above the age of 50. So not a lot of young people that will try new ways of doing stuff, let's say. That means it's hard for them to access programs. They do not know how to write projects. They don't know how to improve their way of production. And also something that we notice is the way how the subsidy system in Macedonia works. It creates very inefficient value chains and actually contributes to food loss and waste. But due to political reasons, it's really hard that any politician in the country will change this subsidy system. So our end result, actually, we decided that there are three key areas of strategies that need to be done in order to address the food loss and waste. We need to address the low professionalism that's going on in the system of how production is being conducted. Then the lack of information that is a problem for everyone in the system. And here, a huge part of it has the state that has, I would say, poor way of how it informs and helps farmers on the field. And then also there is the old way of farmers, how they want to get information, and they're looking for information. And there is really something that needs to be done here in order to approach them. And of course, lack of investment of different kinds, as you will see, are lacking and is actually creating directly food losses and waste. I mean, not just the transport part, but also other parts. Here you'll see some of the strategies that we think will address these food losses and waste. But this is for Macedonia. And in some of these areas, in the last years, there are certain actions that have been, because they have shown that are good practices in order to cut food loss and waste. For instance, I think I see that some of the attendees have also been part of this project that, as we can see, it happened in 2012. But while we were doing this field research in 2019, we were able to notice that the training that the NGOs have done, this is, I think, was part of a bigger or larger project, has changed how a lot of people are doing their greenhouses. For instance, a lot of them are using the UV shade nets, people were explaining us how a lot of trainings, a lot of working with the local population, using the right people to share the information in the local municipalities, have actually helped people to see directly the results. People were not believing that some UV shade will create that kind of result. So we really believe that trainings are a good way to work with farmers and cut food loss and waste. This kind of simple UV shading nets have helped to improve their quality, prevent sunburning, and other aspects of the production. Because we have also seen that incentivizing, for instance, cooperatives and people joining together and working together is something that creates great results in cutting food loss and waste. The state has certain measures that is doing in order to support cooperatives. Not enough, but still something is going on. And there is also a lot of international donor help that's still going on in this sector. And I think it's helping more or less for farmers to see what are the benefits of working together. I will want to show some of the pictures, the cooperative Krani in the Prespa region that we've seen and we talked with their members. First and foremost, they did a joint sale of apples, and that has cut a lot of the food losses and waste that are occurring when there is problems with selling of apples. Unfortunately, because of the old method that Macedonian farmers are using, the old varieties that they are producing, and other unfavorable conditions, Macedonia has a good apple year. Just if Poland or some of the other manufacturers, producers of apples have a bad year. If not, then huge quantities of apples are just staying in the country, being thrown everywhere. And then those are thousands of apples, tons of apples that are everywhere. But even in a bad year, the cooperative economy has shown us that if farmers join their sale and work together with retailers and wholesalers, they can seriously decrease of this food loss and waste that is going on. Also, they have cut food and loss by creating, building their own water irrigation system with their own money, and this has improved, greatly the whole value chain that they're being part of. So I believe that investments in cooperatives and farmers working together is a good way to cut food loss and waste. Then we coming about the lack of information part. Something that my NGO has introduced is the food loss, is the food redistribution application, web platform that we have built. Here you can see 13 tons of apples that this cooperative Krani has donated to us. So as I showed you in the previous picture, they have sold a lot, most of their apples, and they just left 13 tons and they donated to us. And through our web platform that we have built, they were able to share those apples together with NGOs that work with people with that have this need of the need of this food, and that was really quickly in a day redistributed, and it showed how much technology can help actually be accessible this kind of the platforms. So yeah, some information is something that is very important, as you will see here. I don't have the picture, but those people that maybe know is, agrometeorological stations are very important, and farmers getting the information on time helps really a lot for them to prepare all the measures needed. So what we've seen also in the Prespa region is that new agrometeorological stations that were applied there, actually the research after that showed that it decreased spraying trees by up 30% and improved a lot of the quality of the apples themselves. Just a simple SMS that the farmers are getting before there is any rain or any other forecast, that any alert they need to get, it helps them so much, and it's very cheap system that is being placed. So good information in the right time from farmers is very important. Here there are certain measures that the state doing, but I think there is a need for more. And these other programs that you can see, like buyback of agricultural surpluses, this is something that there's some program that the state enforces, but it's still not fully working. So we can say that it's good. And then the extension service is not really working, and I believe here we need some good practice in the future. Lack of investment. We were reviewing EPARC and other governmental programs. There is huge need for innovation and technological development, and actually connecting performances of farmers with the extension services, rewards, and penalization. In this part, as a good practice, we were able to see, and this is not just in 2019, but this is even being lately, certain municipalities like in Kolchani, there is it's very visible that how rural infrastructure really helps cutting food loss and waste. So I was talking to different producers here in Kolchani, and the new infrastructure that was set by the municipality actually helped them to cut the instances where transport has damaged the products, because they're taking the products from their farm to their house where they're doing the sorting and the storaging. Processing capacity. Processing capacities, as you can see on the left picture, here, this is in Strumica, and this is one of the main reasons why the paper value chain is more stable than all the others, just because new processing capacities have opened up, so products that are not marketable or maybe are hard to reach any consumer, even with the lower prices, it can go for processing, and this is actually not only cutting food loss and waste, but also creating additional value of the product, and is being a very important export opportunity for the country. And just new processing capacities are coming up every year. And on the right here, you can see a huge storage that was built in the Prespa region. And this is a very controlled area. I think they're monitoring very closely, introducing certain gases that are helping the storaging. They are decreasing levels of O2, CO2, everything that is needed for the apples to last for a much longer period. And this is cutting a lot of food loss, a lot of food losses and waste, improving how much the apples are worth and actually make it more profitable for farmers. And it's a good example of how much storaging is important in this whole story that we're trying to tell. And actually, I mean, that capacity on also, that is now the only capacity of that kind. It's still cutting hundreds and hundreds of tons of food loss and waste every year, just because how they work. So more or less, those are the good examples I wanted to showcase. Unfortunately, there is not in the area a lot of them, but there is huge opportunities for things to be done in a much, much better way. If you have any questions that I can answer, feel free to ask me.
Thank you, Blas. Thank you very much for this practical example from the field, and the research that you did, the work that you did on food loss and waste analysis in North Macedonia. I have received two questions. The first one, it's a long one, but I'm not very sure if it is addressed to Anatoly or to Blaž. Let me just read the question, and then Anatoly or Blaž, you can see if you can answer it. It's from a researcher. His name is Edip Alas. He works in the field of vegetable breeding in Turkey. And there it appears that the farmers who produce their products and deliver them to the consumers. And now, since the consumers buy at high prices, but there are brokers in between, of course, traders, retailers, etc., the producer cannot make enough profits, despite that the consumer buying at a high price. So apparently, most of the value added goes to the brokers in between. And in some years, the harvest costs, that is the main point, the harvest cost of the product is higher than the product price, than the farm price. So, and that leads that the farmer rather lets the product rot in the field than harvest it, because otherwise he will lose money by harvesting his produce. So this is an interesting situation. We see that quite often happening, that there is a distortion of the profits and the benefits going to the different actors in the food supply chains, and where the farmers getting the low, an inequitably low price for that produce. And this is causing, apart from that it is unfair, it is also causing food losses. If the cost of harvest indeed is higher than the field price, then the food will be left in the field and will get lost. So the question is, if you, either Anatoly or Blaž, have experienced or have observed this situation, and how can you resolve the issue? What are your recommendations in this sense?
Okay. The final of value chain, this is harvest, storage, and sale of the product. First of all, the problem is you need to have a good planting materials adaptive of the local condition. and also to decrease the cost of the planting materials and the raw materials we use for obtain or finally products. Because the change of the climate change here in Moldova during the last 10 years decreased the yield for big number of the products. For example, 10 years ago, it's not a problem to obtain a 5-6 ton of the strawberry. And the moment they have a possibility to obtain 5-6 ton only if the farmers use healthy and high quality planting materials and also obligation irrigation. And other problem and the loss of the food, it's a conjecture of the market. For example, the finally price for the farmers, it's a little bit a half of the final price who consumer pay. Other half of the price, this is intermediary. And for the farmers, it's too difficult to adaptate of the market. And we propose to, for the farmers to make a farmers formal or informal associated to buy common or sell common the products. And the, our case, it's work very good for farmers group like a producers group, formal group. And for this group in Moldova, we establish 31 cold storage. More this cold storage is oriented for apple, for table grapes, and only two for berry. But this is a opportunity for the farmers to decrease your loss of harvest or loss of yield, because
all right, I think this is indeed the very good recommendation that for farmers to have a stronger position in the value chain and get the right price for their produce is to organize themselves so that they can have a stronger negotiation position towards the buyers, instead that every small farmer just sells in the moment that he that the buyer passes by. And so and at the same time, if they are organized into a cooperative or an association, they can also have access to they get in a cheaper way access to their inputs, like the planting materials, like the irrigation facilities, the storage facilities, etc. And so I think this really answers the question of Mr. Edip Alas as well. Then the next question from Armando Cortes, I think that is for Blaž. And it is, can you elaborate more, why do subsidies create a negative incentive?
Yes, so in the case of Macedonia, the subsidies are connected with how much land the farmer has. It's not connected of the quantities that they are producing. So they're not incentivized for them to create a good quality product that is well marketed, that, I mean, everything that is involved in that sense, but just to have the land. And in many cases, many people are getting involved in agriculture in Macedonia that are not interested for the production, but for the subsidies themselves. So they're just planting subsidized trees, getting land from the state, they're just planting it. And nobody, I mean, when a monitoring is coming, they're saying, cool, there are trees, there is some kind of dripping irrigation system. And every year they're getting subsidies. And actually, they're making more money in this way than actually selling the product. So we have thousands upon thousands of tons in Macedonia in different value chains just because of this kind of practices. So in the case of Macedonia, this kind of subsidy system has created huge manipulations, a lot of forgery by the real and actually the fake producers in the country. So I think that actually connecting subsidies with the quality of the products, how much has been sold, will help the professionalization of the system, but also cutting the food losses and waste. And this has proved to be right in the case when there were subsidies connected if the farmers are giving the products for processing. And this has helped a lot of products to be saved from food loss and waste. So I believe if the right subsidies are in the right place, they can help food loss and cut food loss and waste. But in this case, and how is now in Macedonia, everything is operating. It's just discouraging the farmers that are, I mean, I would say the real farmers, and it's helping, let's say, the fake farmers just to make money out of working nothing.
All right. Well, this is going to bring us to the end of this webinar. The setup has been such that we first had a presentation on academic and innovative research from the Wageningen University. And then this was complemented by two very clear practical examples on the post-harvest sector in the field from Moldova and North Macedonia. And I hope that both sides, both the people working at the production level and the people working at the research level, that they have benefited from each other. Still, I would like to give Josian and Hans a chance, 1 minute, to make a final take-home message for the audience, if you feel like that.
Hi, Hans, do you want to go first, or you're still muted? Thank you very much, everybody. I hope that your take-home message is, for my part, is that if we're organized the whole supply chain, we can reach more together than try to tackle unique single problems. Of course, it's a start if we do so, but to bring bigger changes, we need to tackle down the entire supply chain. And so, yeah, I hope to get in touch with you on that matter. Thank you very much.
Hans, you have anything to add?
Yeah, just maybe to add one sentence that we can think about all kinds of technology, CA storage, or even more sophisticated, but it can also be the very small things in the total chain which can already make a difference, like for instance what I told, checking your temperature sensor, or looking to the right varieties, or make a more efficient cooling of the product, which doesn't have to cost a lot, but can already make differences in reducing food losses.
All right, thank you again. And then I will finally, again, thank everybody who contributed to this webinar. I think it was very successful. We had a very good audience. We had many and a wide variety of different questions, which are very to the point and they were well answered. As I said before, all the presentations will be shared with you, as well as this whole webinar has been recorded and will be made available as well. And any outstanding questions which are there will be answered by email, either by us or by the panel members, and because we will share them with you. And if you have any more things to ask, just send us or send to the panel members your questions. That would be the right thing to give it some follow-up, because then it will have a bigger impact and a bigger benefit for all of us. So first of all, many thanks to the panel members, Blas, Anatoly, Hans, and Josiane, as well as Miriam, to address all these technical and practical issues in the post-harvest sector in the region so professionally and so adequately well. And of course, I am very grateful to the minds behind the scenes to make all this possible. First of all, Oksana, who organized the whole webinar, and the support from Linda and Roland, as well as the interpreters to make this all a success. And this is very encouraging for us to continue with the next webinar in this series, which will be announced very soon. I wish you all a very nice afternoon, and do stay in touch if you feel the need. We will be happy to address further issues that come up. Bye-bye, and have a nice day.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.